worked out good. I was going to talk about something kind of negative, but the Lord told me no. Forget about that. I was just going to talk about this guy that's staying in the building that I live, that's been annoying me for the past weeks, but the Lord took him out of my way and he's not going to bother me anymore.
Praise the Lord.
I typically read out of the English Standard Version translation. And one thing that I like about the translation is that in every chapter or section, it has kind of a title for what it's about. So I was asking God, what do you want me to talk about today? For some reason, I was led to Isaiah 55. And I want to read the whole chapter. It's not too long. And then the English Standard Version calls this chapter the Compassion of the Lord. So it says, "Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And he who has no money, come, buy, and eat. Come, buy wine and milk, without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me here, that your soul may live. And I will make you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. Behold, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. Behold, you shall call a nation that you do not know, and a nation that did not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God and the Holy One of Israel, for he was glorified. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out of my mouth. And it shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose, and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy, and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall make a name for the Lord, an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off." To me, the verses that spoke the most as to what I've been feeling was verses 8 and 9. "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither your ways are my ways. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." I was thinking today, you know, sometimes we don't understand where the Lord is taking us, and we just got to trust him. Well, you all know everything that's been going on with me for the past 2 years, and I think it's very interesting how he moves, because I remember a very wise man told me once that although the desire of God was to make my relationship renewed, if both parts are not willing to, he'll still give me that person that is going to fulfill the desires of my heart. Mm-hmm. And it's a person that I'm going to be able to share my faith with and grow with as well. Well, I recently met someone that right now all signs point to that. So I don't know what's going to happen. I'm still trusting that the plan he has for me, the promise he has for me, maybe the promise that when he told me I am taking care of this, is not in the way that I thought it was going to be. Mm-hmm. All I know is that I've been singing and I'm joyful, and someone talked to me at work, hey, you got to stop singing too much because people are complaining. And I was thinking, you know, that's fine, I can do it, but I'm not singing just to bother people. It's because there's a lot of joy in my heart because good things are happening, you know. My mother's coming, my sister's coming, and they're going to be here with me. I haven't seen them for almost 2 years, and they're going to come here and meet this family that I have, which is very exciting for me. And, you know, just, I'm not going to try and make sense of some of the things that are happening, because he says it right there. His ways are better than my ways, and his thoughts are greater than my thoughts.
Amen.
So I will trust and believe what he says with my heart, but I will not try to rationalize what he's trying to do in my life, because that's just going to drive me crazy. Mm-hmm. So it is well. That's all right.
Amen. Sometimes all parties aren't cooperative.
Mm-hmm.
So I heard Joseph Prince for the last couple of days too talking about restoration. And there is a law in Leviticus where if someone takes something from you,
yes,
God does not only give you back 100% of what was taken, but he adds another fifth to it, or 20% more. So in a relationship, what that means is, obviously you're not going to get a woman and a half, or a woman and a half, but you're going to get the quality of the relationship that is 100% plus another 20% greater than even what you hope for or imagine. So that's what restoration is all about, and that's what redemption is all about. So, you know, we want what God's perfect will is, and that's what you've been trying to do and trying to work through. But when that doesn't happen, no fault of your own, through no fault of your own, then God restores.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really what he's talking about even here in Isaiah 55, is that it's not what we can achieve. And I think God knows, and most of us that know you know that you've done everything humanly possible and to try to restore and establish and maintain and so forth. I'm not saying what it is or what it isn't. That's that's not for me to decide. But if anything is taken from us, then God's given us a promise that not only will he restore what has been taken, regardless of what it is in relationship.
share anything? Prayer request?
I have a prayer request.
Okay.
Sorry. I got it on the way to church. There's a gal that Dan works with. Apparently, they have talked. I know he talks to her all the time. But somewhere in their conversation, they have talked about prayer cloths. And so she came to him and asked him if he would pray for 2 prayer cloths for a Callie Brumbaugh and a Brenda Abel. So if you have a couple tonight that we can pray for, and he'll take to work to this gal that I'm believing not only for those people's healing, but to sprout her seeds. Stuff
yeah.
They've obviously talked about. So
praise the Lord.
Amen.
Yes, Tim.
If we continue to appreciate your prayers, because they do make a difference
mm-hmm.
when, you know, people take time out of their life and pray for your request. We're going to have a meeting on Friday with people involved in the situation. And, you know, we just love it when God goes before you,
mm-hmm.
you know, and we can pray that God's will is done in that situation. You know, today I was coming home and got delayed getting home from work, but there's a Christian program come on, has, you know, prayer requests and different things on there. And when the woman that had the issue of blood for 12 years, and she was pushing through the crowd because she just thought, if I could just touch the hem of Jesus' garment. Now, I've been in big crowds like football games where, you know, sometimes people kind of brush up against you, but it's different when somebody's trying to get your attention.
Mm-hmm.
You feel that difference in the crowd.
Yeah.
And Jesus felt that. You know, the virtue went out of him. Who touched me? And the disciples said, who touched you? There's all these people around. No, somebody touched me different. Somebody wanted to reach out to me. And then that was the woman. And you know, and
yeah.
he turned around and stopped. And you know, she was trembling, came before. And then, Jesus said, who touched me? And she just let everything out. You know, told the truth and let everything out. And that made a difference. She spent all of her living. You know, she went to all the doctors. She's done everything on the human side. But that's only one part of it. Because
mm-hmm.
now she went to the God side.
Yeah.
And that made a world of difference in there.
Mm-hmm.
But she bared her heart. And I think that's really where God wants to come.
Yes.
To provide those changes in her life. And that just really touched me today. Because we've been dealing with this situation with BB. We've been doing a lot of stuff. You know, but you know what? God understands your heart.
Yes.
You lay it all before him.
Yes.
You know, I've seen God move. You know, I always think about when Jesus said, I am the way. People say, I don't know which way to go. There's no other way to go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Jesus
yeah.
said, I am
yeah.
the way.
That's right.
Yes.
The
yes.
truth
yes.
and the life. So we just appreciate your prayers, but
yes.
For that meeting that we're going to be having. Right?
Yes.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Amen.
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 Mike.
Yes.
Yeah, my daughter, Jenny, who was here once, a while back when they were visiting, she's been fighting back pain. We prayed about it a few weeks ago, and she's at the point of going in for surgery. She says they don't have any money. I don't know about their insurance situation. She's basically asking for me to ask the family if they can help her with the funds and stuff like that. And, well, first of all, I want her healed. I want her also to understand that, yes, we are here for her to help her. That's why we're family. She has the uninsurance that we would stand with her in all these situations, so the confidence of our love for her
mm-hmm.
needs to be revealed. But like I said, I believe in her healing. We pray for it. I just need to stand on it and see it come to pass. So she's got running sciatica. She looked at something about a year ago, I think she has a herniated, she thinks she has a herniated disc, but I believe it's just something that's already being healed and being taken care of. So.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Anyone else? James.
I'm going to give a prayer over anxiety. Well, I'm not real, but I play a farmer's market and then a neighbor that's kind of been irritable. And she shouldn't be, especially on Sunday morning of a God moment to be in face with God on Sunday morning. I really would appreciate my space to play 5-10 minutes on that. I mean, even though she does not really realize that that's
die tonight, when you go to heaven, you know, I don't know, you know, telling my story, and she was so on fire, you know, it was a really uplifting experience for both of us. I just pray that she keeps her zeal, that
Amen.
God rekindles the fire in all of us like the new Christian.
Yeah.
Nothing like a new Christian.
That's right. Yeah. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, well, let's stand. Let's thank the Lord for bringing us into His presence today. Father, thank You for allowing us to gather here in Your name. You said, Lord, that where two or three are gathering in Your name, that's where You will be. And we know that Your presence is here in this place right now. We are receiving Your Holy Spirit, the outpouring of Your grace, Lord. We thank You, Father, for the revelation that You give us through Your word, through the testimonies of those that are here, that are not here as well, those that are behind us. sensing that change in the atmosphere.
Mm-hmm.
To me, when that happens, it's, I feel like the door's been open.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just waiting for whoever's there to just go running through it.
Amen. 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 Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
That's just what I feel.
Tomorrow,
National Day of Prayer. We really need it.
worship you, Lord. Worship you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you.
is to rebuild by sacrifice. God's perfect plan gave up his life to ransom back the lost and damned, paying a price justice demands. As he was broken, heaven was open, our judgment lifted, our sins acquitted. His loving kindness freely invites us into the realm of grace. Sing a new song, sing of his goodness, sing of his goodness, sing of his wonderful love. True love was shown, defined, as he was scorned and crucified. He tore the veil, bridged the divide, taking us from darkness to light. His grave is broken, his grave is open, our judgment lifted, our sins acquitted. His loving kindness freely invites us into the realm of grace. Sing a new song, sing of his goodness, sing of his goodness, sing of his wonderful love.
Thank you. Jesus. Father, we thank you for what you've already done in this service. Thank you for answered prayer, Lord. We celebrate the victory, Lord, over every one of these situations. Though they're in our future, Lord, you've already seen the end result. And we celebrate with you right now in the victory that you've promised us, Lord. That whatsoever we believe when we pray, we receive it. And we know, Lord, nothing is impossible with you. And whatever we ask, according to your will, you hear us. And Lord, if you hear us, then we have our request. We celebrate that right now, Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that even though we live in the seen world, you work in the unseen, Lord. Bringing into reality, Lord, bringing into our reality what has always been your reality. Victory. Hallelujah. In every situation, over every circumstance, over every enemy of your children. And we bless you right now, Lord. And thank you, Jesus. You are a great and a mighty God, Lord. There truly is none like you. You alone are worthy. And we praise you tonight. In Jesus' name. Everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Thank the Lord. Praise God. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, worship team. As always, appreciate the prayer requests and the testimonies. Thank you for sharing with us. Amen. God is good. And I said last Wednesday I'd be brief, so I'm not lying to you 2 weeks in a row. Praise the Lord. I just got the victory over last week. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So we're going to get right to it. Amen. I'd like us to start as soon as Roberto's settled there with Galatians chapter 1 and verse 6. Praise the Lord. God is good. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. I just encourage you that whatever you're praying about, whatever your need is, that you just, over the next, the actual earth time here that's going on, that you just thank the Lord now for what you're asking Him. Just praise Him. Don't wait until afterwards. We get excited afterwards, and that's only normal. I mean, we should, but we ought to be just as celebratory and as excited while we're waiting for the manifestation, because it is done. Amen. He's going to do it. Amen. And we just have to be excited about it. Praise the Lord. We look at things that are not as though they are. That's what makes us unique. That's the way God operates. And, we are recipients of God life, eternal life. Amen. So we need to live out of that reality. Amen. So here is Galatians chapter 1, verse 6, and Paul is writing to the church at Galatia, and he says, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. Now, we could read on, if we were to read on in that, and I'm not going to for the sake of time, you'll see that he goes on and on about, he said that it's not another gospel. There's only one gospel, but he said, you know, you're believing something that isn't that gospel. And that's the challenge really for all of us. These were believers. These were Christians that were born again. But they had deviated from the original truth, the original gospel, and had kind of picked up some other stuff along the way. Amen? All right, so let's go now to Colossians chapter 1, and we'll read verses 21 through 23. And you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. If ye continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel which ye have heard, and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister. Now, I'm not fluent in any language other than English, and some might even argue how fluent I am in English, but nevertheless, this is the language I understand. I can speak a little bit of Spanish, a little bit of German, but I mean very limited. I wouldn't get far. I might make it in a bar, because I know how to order a drink just about in any country. Hallelujah. Sad, but that's the truth. Praise the Lord. But so just imagine, I wake up one morning, and suddenly all I can speak is German. I don't know any other language. I can't speak any other language. I don't understand any other language. I can only speak German. Or at the same time, I can't remember anything about my life. So I'm speaking German, but I don't remember anything about me, right? So I guess I'd move to Germany, right? Praise the Lord. Well, the point I'm trying to make is that we can move from reality, from the reality of grace alone, Jesus alone, the cross and the empty tomb alone. We can deviate from that. We can move from that. Now, in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 16. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine, continue in them, for in doing this thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. So take heed unto thyself. In other words, realize what's going on with you, and also the doctrine, and continue in them. Continue in what you've learned of the doctrine, because in doing that, not only do you save yourself, but you save them that hear you. Now he's speaking to a minister, but let's face it, we are all kings and priests in the body of Christ. All of us minister. I mean, that's what we do just with our lives, amen? But if we don't stay focused on our beliefs, on our gospel, amen, an attack of theological amnesia can leave us speaking moralism and legalism and living like a foreigner to the gospel of the kingdom of Christ.
Yeah.
And it doesn't take much. You know, you can hear, I've said this before, but you can hear the gospel over and over and over. You can hear grace messages over and over and over. But it doesn't take 5 minutes in the presence of legalistic, you know, hellfire, threatening condemnation before you start getting nervous.
Right.
You know, I mean, it's just the nature, amen, of the beast. We have to center ourselves on the gospel in order to shape our identities and our activity. You have to stay focused on Jesus, who is grace, amen, or you will deviate. You will start picking up stuff that isn't helpful to you, and it certainly isn't going to be helpful to anybody else. Amen? Let's go back to Colossians again here, 1 and verses 22 and 23. Okay, in the body of his flesh, through death, to present you holy and unblameable, unreprovable in his sight, if you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel, which ye have heard, and which was preached to every creature, which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister. Amen? So God doesn't want us moving away from the hope of the gospel. He doesn't want us to focus on anything other than what the gospel provides, the hope that is in that gospel. A Christianity that is filled with good intentions, with good advice, separate from the good news, is bad news. And it's bad advice. Amen? Let's look at this. Titus chapter 2, verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. Drop down to verse 14. Who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Now, holy people. How do we become holy? By grace. By God. By what Christ has done for us. He has made us righteous, holy, acceptable to God, because of His holiness, amen, because of His redemption, amen. So, we're holy people, but earthly power is never going to accomplish this. We can't do it.
No.
We can't. I don't care. Listen, I was saved in a holiness church. So I know about this. I mean, I know, even though they would say that you're saved by grace,
right,
everything you did from that moment on,
yeah,
was based on what you did, mm-hmm, and whether you would then be accepted by God as a result of how you behaved. Amen? The way you dressed, where you went, what you did. I'm not condemning these people because I love them. If it hadn't been for them, I mean, they showed me the Lord. They brought me to a place where I could receive Christ.
Right.
And so I love them. I have many friends still. And I'm grateful to them for bringing me to a place where I could receive Christ. But there's so many other things that deviate from the gospel. I'm going to talk about it even more Sunday, but I just want to say that earthly power is not going to accomplish what only divine power can do.
Exactly.
It just cannot happen.
Exactly.
That's basically what he's talking about in Isaiah 55. I was reading today in the Tanakh, and I was, you know, it's a word-for-word translation of the Hebrew. You have the Hebrew, and then you have the English. And so it's a little different than what we read in any of our translations because it's literally exactly an English word for the Hebrew word. So it doesn't come out exactly the same. But what it tells you is that God is saying, I don't know why you're trying, in verses 1 and 2, what do you think you're going to do with money? I mean, how are you going to purchase the bread that you really need? We don't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And he's saying, you're trying to get something that you don't have any real anything to exchange for. Right? I mean, you don't have any purchasing power within yourself when it comes to things of the Spirit. It comes by the Spirit. I mean, it's a gift from God. We're not going to get it, amen, if it takes God to provide it. We're not going to get it through our own abilities and through our own strength. That's why we can't focus on us, amen, but focus on the gospel, on Jesus,
right,
on grace, amen. We need extraterrestrial power that comes only from the risen Christ.
Right.
I mean, you want to learn something about extraterrestrials, don't bother with the History Channel. Amen. You need to go to the God Channel or somewhere, praise the Lord. I mean, I see that stuff almost every night. I go to sleep listening to it. But thank the Lord, I know these people are just deceived. If there's extraterrestrials out there, they're demonic. I mean, if there's anything coming to earth, amen, outside of Christ, it ain't coming from God, and it isn't coming from another planet. Amen. It's coming from another dimension. Praise the Lord.
Right.
But we need, the terrestrial is never going to provide what only the extraterrestrial can do. And the extraterrestrial, the only one that I'm interested in, is the risen Christ, who isn't a terrestrial being right at this moment. Amen. He's been on this terra firma, but he's not here now except in us.
Right.
Praise the Lord. He's seated at the right hand of the Father. Amen. In another dimension. Praise the Lord. So this what we need is not found in our own strength, but in the strength of Jesus. That's why we spent the first half hour here praying, right? I mean, if we could do it, why would we be praying about it? We'd just go do it. Amen. There's stuff that we can't do, but there's nothing that God can't do. And He will do all things, amen, that we will believe Him for. That is being spiritual. Amen. That's, we talk about spiritual power. You know, we talk about anointings and so forth. You know, listen, we're spiritual so much of the time and don't even realize it because we've kind of been led to believe that the spiritual is somebody that's on a platform doing some spiritual thing, when in fact we are spirit beings. Our lives are spiritual, whether we understand it or not. There is an unseen spirituality. There is an anointing on each and every one of us because we have Christ. He's the only anointing there is. Everything flows from that. There is an anointing on each one of us that we don't even realize, but other people recognize it. They may not know what it is, and to some, It's the smell or the aroma of salvation or blessing. And to others, it's the aroma of death. Amazing. Same spirit, but totally different reactions. Amen. So sometimes you're accepted. You're people just drawn to you. Amen. Why? Because the spirit is drawing. And other people hate you. For no reason other than the spiritual that they don't even understand. Right?
Amen.
We're spirit beings. We have impact. We have influence in this earth. Just the fact that we're here is an influence. If that were not true, we wouldn't be here and the Antichrist would be operating free in this earth right now. Think about it. He said the thing that restrains is the Holy Spirit. Well, the Holy Spirit is here and active only in us. So we're restraining all kind of hell. In fact, we are restraining the tribulation, amen, the full-blown tribulation, just by the simple fact that we are here on this earth. Because when we're gone, Katie, bar the door. It ain't going to be a fun place to be. You think it's screwed up and chaotic here now? And it certainly is, and it's getting only worse as we live. All of us have seen this just in our lifetimes. But you can only imagine, people say, I've been living in hell. You may have been living in a mess, but you have no idea what hell's going to be. You have no idea how evil things can be. Ask the Jews that went through the Holocaust.
Right.
I mean, there was a lot of them that thought things were bad, you know? Right? Ask African Americans that were actually in slavery.
Right.
I mean, there's hell. But that isn't even a comparison to what hell will be.
Right.
Tribulation is going to be hell on earth.
Yeah.
Literally, it's going to be just the most evil that man can be, free to be evil, without any restraints. The church restrains evil. Even, think about it, with all the evil that there is,
mm-hmm.
we are still restraining evil.
Sure.
Yeah.
So only imagine how bad it could be if we aren't here.
Yeah.
Right.
Now, if we have that influence, we ought to be taking advantage of it. Let me
Come
say
on.
It that way.
There you go.
We ought to use our influence for good.
Amen.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. People ought to be attracted to us.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And we ought to cooperate, amen, with the Spirit.
Yes.
Our Spirit, it knows what to do.
Mm-hmm.
It'll do it automatically. It'll attract people. Problem is, our flesh will drive them off. It'll run away. Amen? I mean, come on, we know that's true. Sometimes God's trying to work and we're just not in the mood for it. It's a shame, but it's true. We just need to be more sensitive to the extraterrestrial us rather than the terrestrial. We're in this world, but we're not of this world. We are on this terrestrial plane, but we are extraterrestrial. We are supernatural.
Yes.
We live in a natural body, but nevertheless, we are supernatural beings. The moment we got born again, we became eternal creatures, new creatures in Christ.
Amen.
One of a kind, totally separate and different from everything else on this planet.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So, back to Colossians 1:23. If you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel which ye have heard, and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereby Paul made a minister. So if you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel. Now, he wouldn't be saying that if it wasn't possible for it to happen.
Right.
Now, I'm not talking about losing our salvation. I'm talking about losing the power and the influence that that brings.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. Any supernatural event that takes place through the hands of a human being or through the prayers of a human happens by grace.
Uh-huh.
It doesn't happen by our power.
That's right.
It happens by His power,
uh-huh.
by grace being released to us and through us.
Yes.
And if we lose the hope, the truth of the gospel, we lose our influence. We lose our ability to influence this earth and the circumstances and situations that we're confronted with. Amen. The hope of the gospel is Jesus Himself.
Mm-hmm.
He is grace. Grace is a person.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. When we are weak, He is strong.
Yes.
Amen. When we're confused, He's clear-headed. We have the mind of Christ. I mean, how many of you ever get confused? I mean, you know, you got situations and they just overwhelm you, and they just, it's like you can't even think straight about how to deal with it. When you focus on Jesus, what happens? You get the mind of Christ. Things start to settle down. I'm not saying the problem necessarily goes away, but your attitude towards the problem takes on a different focus. You begin to think, you begin to have hope. Hope in what? Hope in the gospel. Why? You're focused back on Him and not on you. Not on your natural man, but the Christ in you, the hope of glory.
Yes.
You begin to see things positive. Just like Roberto said this evening. I was going to say something to you, but it's negative, and the Lord told me not. Well, that's not surprising. God's not negative. We are.
Come on.
Right? I mean, our flesh takes a negative look at almost everything.
Sure.
Because we know the worst possible scenario that could come from it, because we've heard it all of our lives. Oh, you got that symptom? Oh, my aunt died of cancer that had that, you know? Or the banker told you that? Oh, yeah, my cousin filed bankruptcy, went through the same thing. You know, I mean, it's always negative. Instead of, oh, really? Well, my God said He'd supply all of my needs according to His riches and glory. My God said He would restore all my relationships. Amen. My God said that no weapon formed against me can prosper. My God said that every tongue that rises in judgment is against me, I will condemn, because this is the heritage of a servant of the Lord, and His righteousness, or my righteousness, is of Him.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. It takes us a while, usually, to think in our home language.
Yes.
Right? We're waking up speaking German, amen, and don't remember who we are.
Right? Exactly.
Right? And we're thinking, I'm in the wrong place, you know. How do I relate to all of this? You've got to go back to your true identity. You've got spiritual amnesia is what you've got. You've got theological amnesia. You need to, hallelujah, praise the Lord. You need the right hand of faith right upside the head, praise the Lord. Your own hand right upside the head. Wake up, shake me a moment here. And realize, hey, I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I speak spirit. I speak truth. The words that I speak are spirit and their life. I can say that because Jesus, that's what Jesus said, my words, the words that come out of my mouth are spirit and they are truth. Spirit words are true words, and they change the falseness and the lies, amen, that we're confronted with every single day in this world. Now, what is it anything other than a lie? If God has said one thing and we're experiencing something else, there may be two facts involved, but there's only one truth. There can only be one truth. There may be factual things going on, evidence, but there can only be one thing that's true. And the one thing that's true is what God has said.
Yes. Yes.
Let God be true and every man a liar. Every man, any man that's saying anything other than what God said is lying. I'm not being mean. I'm just saying, that's the truth. Whether he realizes he's lying or not, it's a whole other issue.
Sure.
Right? But uninformed people say things all the time that aren't true.
That's right.
They believe that they're true, but that doesn't make them true.
That's right.
This is truth.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
Regardless of what I believe, regardless of what I think, this is the truth.
Amen.
This is reality.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And everything else is temporary, wavering, fading, rising, and falling. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. So, when we feel devastated, when we feel crushed, because we're failing to be like Christ, what does God say? As He is, so are you in this present world. You can't fail. You cannot fail. Amen. You may look in the mirror and you've had a day that just didn't look much like Jesus, but God is still saying, in this world, right now, on this planet, in this realm, you are extraterrestrial. You are as Christ is.
Yes.
You have influence.
Thank you, Jesus.
You can change things.
Mm-hmm. Come on.
Amen. You are the Word made flesh.
Yes.
Christ in you, the hope of glory. You just have to agree with the Word that's in you.
Yes.
You have to agree and let those words come out of your mouth, amen, and believe.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
And if you don't believe, say it anyhow, and you'll begin to believe.
Yes.
They inspire even us. I mean, there's been times when I just didn't know what was going on, and I'd just start reading the Psalms. Didn't know where to go, didn't even know where to go look for a promise. Just start reading the Psalms. And it wasn't, but you get through two or three Psalms and you're feeling pretty good about yourself again. Amen. There's something about the Word of God, and you could do that anywhere, I suspect, but you just start reading the Word of God and all of a sudden, hope rises. Confidence begins to rise up. You begin to think, we can overcome this. We can get through this. We can do something, amen, to impact this situation and this circumstance. Amen. Romans chapter 7, verse 4. Wherefore, my brethren, ye also are become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that ye should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead, that we should bring forth fruit unto God. Now, let me tell you something. You're not going to produce any offspring. That's the metaphor here, but you're not going to produce any fruit, right? Being married to the law. You can't. You can produce some works, but you can't produce any spiritual fruit, anything that's going to be long-lasting, anything that's going to have any permanent impact. Right? But here's the good news. Your good works don't add anything to the work of Christ, but you are divorced from sin's power because you're married to Christ. Mm-hmm. So sin is no longer a hindrance.
Yep.
I'm not saying sin doesn't exist. I'm just saying it is not a hindrance any longer to us producing fruit by Christ.
Yes.
Amen? If my good works don't affect anything, now that I'm born again, don't add anything to Christ, my ungodly works don't detract anything from Christ, don't take anything away from Christ.
Right.
And it's Christ that's in me that's doing the work, it's not me. Right?
Right?
That's what Jesus even said that himself. It's the Father that's in me, he do the works.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Praise the Lord. I just have to stay focused on the Christ that's in me rather than the me. Praise the Lord.
Right.
Amen. Look at Galatians chapter 2 and verse 14. But when I saw that they walk not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, according to the truth of the gospel, they weren't living according to grace, according to the truth of the gospel, I said unto Peter before them all, if thou, being a Jew, livest after the manner of Gentiles, in other words, you've been freed from the law, and if you can live free from the law, and not as do the Jews, why are you compelling the Gentiles to live as the Jews?
Mm-hmm.
You, as a Jew, are now free from the law,
right,
and you're coming to Gentiles who never had the law in the first place and telling them they got to live by it.
Right.
Right.
Now, that sounds like a lot of churches I've been to. Praise the Lord. Amen. Now, the law is holy. The law is righteous. Right?
Yes.
But it doesn't make you righteous.
No.
Right.
It can't make you righteous. All it can do is prove to you that you're unrighteous.
Right.
That's the intent. That's the purpose of the law.
Right.
Right? So God has set us free from the law through Christ's obedience to the law. Amen. So that we can be the righteousness of God in Christ. He has allowed us to be dead to the law so that we can be married to Christ.
Hallelujah.
And become heirs and joint heirs, amen, with him. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So your good works don't add anything, amen. And we aren't, according to this scripture, we aren't beyond shifting from the gospel to our own effort or to our own works.
Right.
I mean, if Peter and Barnabas weren't exempt,
right,
my guess is we could fall into the same trap.
That's right.
In the right environment, you can get squeezed into behaving as though you're still under the law.
That's right.
That you're still dependent on you to accomplish what only God can accomplish. Let me show you something in Romans chapter 12 and verse 3. Scripture, I read it many, 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 many times and read it and misinterpreted it every time. For I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think. He's talking about humility here. He's not talking about pride. He's talking about what you can produce on your own. Not to think too highly of your own good works or your own efforts or your own what fruits you produce. Amen? Because he says it through the grace given unto me to every man that's among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly according as God hath dealt to every man a measure of faith. Praise the Lord. It's the same mentality that it's what I got to do. It's what I got to do. It's what I got to do. Praise the Lord. I got to do this. I got to do that. God isn't going to be pleased unless I do this. That's not pleasing to God because it's thinking more highly of me than it is of God.
Right.
It's making me the master of my faith. It's making me the author of my faith. It's based on what I do that gives me confidence to come to God. Yeah. Or what I don't do that causes me to feel condemned. God has done it all.
Uh-huh.
Amen? Mm-hmm. We think it's, well, I got to do this. I'm this, I'm that. And we call that humility. No, it's thinking too much of yourself.
Right.
It's thinking too highly of yourself rather than focusing on God.
Uh-huh.
Amen? Revelation chapter 3, verses 17 and 18, please. Talking about rest, you know, I mean, in a sense, that we rest in him. We rest in his finished work. We rest in his grace. We rest. I'm not saying we shouldn't be, reaching out to people and trying to influence people. I'm saying we do it by the Spirit.
Right.
We don't do it by our own effort, our own works, our own abilities. Amen. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire. Now, this is a letter to one of the churches. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich and white in raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that thou shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. Now, they thought they were rich because they had some stuff. They thought they were wise, because they were saying a bunch of stuff, right? They thought they had it all together. Amen. But what the Scripture is telling us, what Jesus is telling us is, you go back to the gospel. Go back to the riches of his grace. Not what you think is riches. Not what you think is power. I'm not saying that God doesn't want to bless us financially. I'm saying they put their confidence in them.
Yes.
In what they had. In what they could do. Well, we know you can have some stuff today and be broke tomorrow. Amen. It happens, praise the Lord. It happens to good people. It happens to hardworking people. I mean, it's happened to all of us probably at some time or another. Right? You can be healthy today. Amen. And shouting the victory. And tomorrow you'll get a diagnosis that is a whole other ballgame. Amen. So you can't put your confidence in yourself or in what you have. You have to put your confidence in what only he can provide.
Exactly.
He can provide divine healing, eternal healing. He can provide riches from glory. He can provide exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask or think.
Amen.
Roberto was talking about relationships. How many of you had relationships you've done everything to mend, to restore, to heal, to bring together? And not that you weren't doing everything you could do and doing good, trying. But, hey, let's face it. Sometimes it ain't enough. We need God. We need God to intervene and change people's hearts and minds. Praise the Lord. And only he can do it. If we can do it, we would have done it. It isn't that we're not motivated to do it or don't, aren't hurt by it or touched by it or, you know what I'm saying? But only God. So we got to go back to the gospel. The righteousness of Christ is freely given to us. The covering for our shame. The opening of our eyes. Right? It all comes at no cost.
Right.
We didn't do anything to get it. Mm-hmm. He just does it.
Right.
That's what he's talking about here. Mm-hmm. Now let's go to Isaiah 55, verses 1 and 2. And see, Isaiah is prophesying here. Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, come ye to buy. Come ye, buy and eat. Yea, come buy wine and milk without money, mm-hmm. without a price. Mm-hmm. That's kind of hard to figure in this world, isn't it? Come buy it, but you don't have anything to buy it with? Wherefore do you spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness.
Yeah.
Look to Jesus. Mm-hmm. He's still off the cross. He's still out of the tomb.
Come on.
And he's still on the throne.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Colossians 1, verses 28 and 29. And we'll wrap up with this. Whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Whereunto I also labor, striving according to his working, which worketh in me mightily.
Amen.
Yeah.
His working works in us mightily.
Amen.
To provide perfection for every human being who comes to Christ.
Amen.
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 God producing faith by grace. Mm-hmm. Now, let me quit with a movie reference since I'm in such a spiritual mood here. At the end of a movie, it goes like this. It's a river runs through it is what it's called, the movie. Anybody's ever seen it? And it's pretty cool. It's about life and fly fishing kind of as a metaphor for the whole thing. And the way it ends, the guy, the one brother has left, his father and his mother have died, and his other brother have died. And he said, I realize he's an old man now, but he's still out there doing the four count fly fishing. And I got goosebumps when I heard it, because it was just like reading scripture. Mm-hmm. We know that in the end, all things come back to God. All things become one again with God. I mean, it's throughout the scripture. Us in Christ, Christ in him, and we all become one. And God is reconciling all things back to him. And that's what this guy says. I realized, he said, that, and you're seeing the clouds and the river, and he's out there, this old man, fishing, that all things become one. Because his father was saying, you know, you can love people without really understanding them. You know, people do stupid stuff, let's face it. Mm-hmm. Things that we can't figure out. Why do they do it? You know, why? We don't understand them. But you can still love them, even without understanding them. Mm-hmm. And he says, so I've come to the understanding that all things become one. And then he said, and a river runs through it.
Mm-hmm.
How about everything comes back to God and the river of life?
Yeah.
That flows out from that throne.
Yes.
I mean, it just
yeah.
fell over me. I mean, I just thought, whew, I don't know. This guy is a believer, but whoever wrote this,
yeah.
if he isn't, he's this close. I mean, you know, isn't it something how
yeah.
even people who are not believers can say the most profound things to somebody who's in the spirit, who has a spiritual perception? You can pick things up from people who are totally carnal. You can get spiritual truths from anything.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
Because even though we're in this world, we're not of it.
Amen.
And we can draw the beauty out of things that others can't even imagine.
Amen.
So don't worry. Be happy.
Hallelujah.
Everything's coming back to God. And there's a river of life that runs right through the middle of it.
Yes.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Whether we understand it or don't understand, and it all happens by grace.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
An old guy I used to listen to years ago. I don't even know if he's still alive now, but I used to listen to him on the radio all the time when I was traveling all over East Texas and Louisiana. And he'd always end his R.W. Shambach. You probably, most of you have heard him. And he'd always end his radio broadcast, and I suppose his TV ones too, with, "You don't have any trouble. All you need is faith in God."
Amen.
Amen. There's a lot of truth in that. Mm-hmm. What we think of is trouble. The only problem we've got is believing God in the face of that trouble. Amen.
Amen.
Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Praise the Lord. God bless you. I did a little better tonight. Kept my word. The Lord bless you. Go in His grace. Watch Him work. And do mighty wonders on your behalf for His glory. In Jesus' name.